In this video, I want to discuss some of the features of the heart and the function of the heart and how these features relate to the function. And then we're going to go back in and we're going to put in a few structures that are not currently on the diagram, at least one, and talk about the heart and its function in fetal life. If you notice, the heart, I have drawn an anterior view, the four chambers are open, and I've drawn half of the heart blue and the other half of the heart red. The structures that I have drawn in blue are dedicated to the pumping of deoxygenated blood. The structures that I have drawn in red are dedicated to the pumping of oxygenated blood. So the heart itself is actually two different pumps, a pump for the deoxygenated blood and a pump for the blood that has been oxygenated. Keep in mind that deoxyhemoglobin, or deoxygenated blood, has more of a darker red purple type color, so we typically represent it as blue in anatomy diagrams, whereas oxygenated blood has a bright red color, so we typically indicate it as red in our diagrams. The first thing I want to do is step back and take a look at the deoxygenated blood half of the heart, which is essentially the right side of the heart. Keep in mind the heart has four chambers, and you should have learned this in lecture, the right and left atria and the right and left ventricles. I'm going to take care of the right side of the heart first. Blood enters into a chamber known as the right atrium. This is deoxygenated blood coming back to the heart. So I'm going to label our right atrium, and that is this chamber of the heart, the right atrium. Deoxygenated blood returning to the heart always returns to the right atrium of the heart. So we can get to the heart through some major blood vessels, blood draining essentially from the diaphragm on up. So the head, neck, upper extremities, and diaphragm will come into this right atrium via a vessel known as the superior vena cava. Almost all of the blood returning to the heart from the diaphragm down, so the abdomen and lower extremities, comes in through the inferior vena cava. And in this diagram, we can see it passes posterior to this portion of the right ventricle and enters here. So this is the opening of my inferior vena cava. I'm going to put an IVC there for inferior vena cava. Blood from the heart itself, from the coronary vessels, also returns to this right atrium after providing the blood with oxygen. And it will enter from a posterior angle. And here we can see the opening of that structure. This is, the structure is the coronary sinus. I'll dash it in. It was coming from that general direction. This is the opening of the coronary sinus. Opening of the coronary sinus. Those are all important structures. Now that we know that blood is returning to the right atrium of the heart, deoxygenated blood returns to the right atrium of the heart. There are a few other ways we can get blood into the right atrium. We won't worry about that right now. Once the blood is collected into the right atrium, we need to send it down into the right ventricle. And it will pass into the right ventricle by going through the right atrioventricular valve. I'm not going to label that, but I'll just color that in. This valve typically has three valve cusps. So it is also known as the tricuspid valve, the right atrioventricular valve, or the tricuspid valve. And you'll learn in lecture that it is connected to some tendinous cords called chordae tendineae, which are connected to papillary muscles. I'm not going to talk about that in this demonstration. That's for your lecture professors. But I do want you to realize that what we're going to do is we're going to take the blood that we've collected in this right atrium, deoxygenated blood, and when that right atrium contracts, it will pass that blood down through the right atrioventricular valve into the right ventricle. That's not very far, so the right atrium does not have a very thick muscle wall. Doesn't have to be very strong. Once in the right ventricle, we're going to take that blood and we're going to pump it out to the lungs where it can be oxygenated. Okay? So out to the lungs. So let's label our right ventricle. Put an X on the right ventricle. So blood enters the right atrium, then passes to the right ventricle. From the right ventricle, that blood is going to go up and out on its way to the lungs, and it will pass through a valve called the pulmonary semilunar valve and enter a structure known as the pulmonary trunk. And I'll just put a PT here for now, for pulmonary trunk. And the pulmonary trunk will split into the right and left pulmonary arteries. So I'll label right here, this will be a left pulmonary artery. And this is going to be very important to us when we come back to the fetal structures. So the oxygenated blood came back to the heart, right atrium, passed to the right ventricle. Right ventricle then pumps that deoxygenated blood up through the pulmonary trunk, which splits into the right and left pulmonary arteries to go to the lungs. Then in the lungs, that blood will become oxygenated. Now notice, here this is an artery. Typically in anatomy, our artery should be colored red, because most of the arteries carry oxygenated blood. But the definition of an artery is a vessel that is carrying blood away from the pumping chambers of the heart. So when this blood left this right ventricle, it is leaving the pumping chamber of the heart. It is now in an artery. But we colored it blue because it happens to be deoxygenated blood. We call this the pulmonary circuit. The blood vessels between the heart and the lungs are reversed color-wise. So we reverse them in our mind. This blue, we might think vein, but no, this happens to be an artery because it's pulmonary circuit. This is blood going away from the heart. So out in the lungs, we pick up the oxygen. And we go through several thousand miles of capillaries in the lungs. About 3,000 miles worth of blood capillaries in the lungs. So the wall of the right ventricle has to be fairly muscular to pump the blood that distance. Lungs not shown in this diagram. When we're done in the lungs, we come back to the heart. Remember now, blood leaving the pumping chambers of the heart was in an artery. Blood returning to the heart is in veins. We've already seen superior vena cava coming to the heart. It's a vein. Inferior vena cava coming to the heart was a vein. But now in this diagram, we actually see four veins coming back. Here's the openings. 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are pulmonary veins. We have four pulmonary veins. These are bringing now oxygenated blood back to the heart, and they are going to enter into the left atrium. So let's label our left atrium. So oxygenated blood coming back to the heart goes to the left atrium through four pulmonary veins. Remember, they're veins because they're returning to the heart. In this case, they have oxygenated blood, so we've colored them red. From the left atrium, we will pass down through a valve that typically has two cusps, commonly known as the bicuspid valve, also known as the mitral valve. More anatomically correct, it is the left atrioventricular valve. That will lead us now down into the left ventricle. The left ventricle will receive the blood from the left atrium, left atrium didn't have to pump that very far, so it has a very thin muscle wall. Then the left ventricle receives this blood, will send this newly oxygenated blood up through the aortic semilunar valve into the aorta. We have the ascending aorta, the aortic arch, and then the descending aorta. So I'll just put aorta here. Out to the body. So left ventricle is going to pump the newly oxygenated blood to the entire body by going up through the aorta and then the various branches thereof. So the left ventricle has to pump to the entire body. That's a long way, roughly 60,000 miles worth of capillaries. So the left ventricle has a very thick muscle wall. This diagram really doesn't do it justice. It should be a much thicker wall of this left ventricle. So there we have the general overview of what's going on in the heart of a living, breathing individual after they have been born. But there are things built into the heart that we need to know that we used as a fetus that we don't need as an adult. Keep in mind, we've got the blood into the right side of the heart so that we could pump it to the lungs. The only reason we sent it to the lungs was to get rid of the CO2 and bring in oxygen. As a fetus, you don't have you don't have oxygen in your lungs, and you can't blow off CO2 by using your lungs. All of that is done by your mother through the vessels of the umbilical cord. But you don't want the very first time the vessels in your lungs see blood to be the time that you need to breathe for the first time, because if there's a problem, then you'll die. So, in fetal life, what we have, blood still comes in. The deoxygenated blood comes into the right atrium. When that right atrium contracts, some of the blood will go down to the right ventricle. But most of that blood bypasses the lungs by passing through a hole in the interatrial septum. There's a hole between the right atrium and the left atrium. In an adult, that hole closes off and it leaves a depression here known as the fossa ovalis. So I'm going to label the fossa ovalis, label that with blue. The fossa ovalis. That is a depression in the wall between the right atrium and the left atrium in the adult. In a fetus, this was actually a hole. We called it the foramen ovale. The foramen ovale was there so that when this right atrium contracted, the majority of blood did not go down into the right ventricle, but rather went straight across into the left atrium, where it would then go to the left ventricle and out through the aorta, thereby bypassing the lungs, because remember, there's no oxygen to pick up in the fetal lungs. So one of the structures we're going to talk about when we look at the models is this fossa ovalis. Remember, in the fetal life, it was a foramen ovale. Here it is fossa ovalis. Another feature we have in fetal life is a structure that connects between the pulmonary trunk and the arch of the aorta. I'll draw it in right here. In the adult, this is known as the ligamentum arteriosum. The ligamentum arteriosum, I'll write that down over here. The ligamentum arteriosum. It is a U, it doesn't look much like it. Arteriosum. In fetal life, remember, we bypassed the lungs partially by going through the foramen ovale directly into the left atrium, where we could join with the left ventricle and on up. Some of the blood, though, did pump to the right ventricle. That right ventricle then contracts and sends blood out to the lungs. Some of the blood will go to the lungs, but remember, we're a fetus. There's no oxygen to pick up there. But a large portion of what made it into the right ventricle does not make it to the pulmonary arteries, but rather comes up the pulmonary trunk and goes through this structure directly into the aorta, where it can then circulate out to the body. In fetal life, the ligamentum arteriosum is an open duct or a tube, and that is called the ductus arteriosus. So on the adult heart, we find the fossa ovalis. Keep in mind that's a fetal remnant of the foramen ovale. And we're going to find the ligamentum arteriosum. That's the fetal, or that's the adult remnant of the fetal ductus arteriosus. So when we go through the demonstrations of the lab models, I don't want to talk about the functions of those structures again. I just want to point them out. So let's recap real quickly, so when I do the models, we don't have to stop and talk about all of the features. Superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and the coronary sinus, bringing deoxygenated blood into the right atrium of the heart. Then we're going to have the right atrioventricular valve between the right atrium and the right ventricle. In the right ventricle, we're going to see the chordae tendineae connected to the valve cusps. Those connect to some smooth projections known as papillary muscles. And then there is rough textured tissue in the ventricles known as trabeculae carnae. They'll cover that in your lecture class. We go up and out, passing a smooth area called the conus arteriosus through the pulmonary semilunar valve to the pulmonary trunk, which will divide to go to the lungs as the left and right pulmonary arteries. Keep in mind, they're blue because they're carrying deoxygenated blood. They're arteries because they are going away from the heart. At this point, we should be able to find that ligamentum arteriosus, the remnant of the fetal ductus arteriosus. So ligamentum arteriosum, remnant of ductus arteriosus. On the right side of the heart, pulmonary veins, two from the right, two from the left, come into the left atrium, bringing in now oxygenated blood. So we've colored them red. They are veins because they're returning to the heart. Left atrium pumps down to left ventricle through the mitral or bicuspid, or more anatomically correct, left atrioventricular valve. We still see chordae tendineae and papillary muscles. Then we pump up through the aortic semilunar valve, through the various portions of the aorta and out through its branches to distribute to the entire body. So when we look at the lab models, I don't want to have to go back over these structures again and again and again. I expect that you will have watched the video and you understand the function of these structures.